Good evening. If you will stand with me, turn to hymn 257. It's good to see everyone here. And I'm excited to sing out with you. So let's turn to hymn 257 and look and live. Amen. Look alive is the alternative title. Amen. Hymn 257. I've a message from the Lord. Hallelujah. The message unto you I'll give. 'Tis recorded in his word. Hallelujah. It is only that you look and live. It's a message from above, hallelujah. Jesus said it, and I know it's true. Look and live, my brother, live. Look to Jesus now and live. Just recorded in his word, hallelujah. It is only that you look and live. Life is offered unto you. Eternal life thy soul shall have. If you'll only look to him, hallelujah. Look to Jesus who alone can save. Look and live, my brother, live. Look to Jesus now and live. 'Tis recorded in his word, hallelujah. It is only that you look and live. On that I will tell you how I came, hallelujah, to Jesus when he made me whole. 'Twas believing on his name, hallelujah, I trusted and he saved my soul. Look and live, my brother, live. Look to Jesus now. Turn over to hymn 247. Hymn 247, saved, saved. Your face needs to turn a little red when you're singing this song, amen? Let's make sure we're singing out on that first verse. I found a friend who is all to me. His love is eternally saved by his power.
Praise the Lord. God's good. Amen. I opened my songbook up here, and I turned to the page, and then I know most of the songs by heart, and I just sang it along, and then I thought, I'm coming to that third verse. How does that start? I couldn't remember. So I put my glasses on, and I realized without my glasses on, I wasn't even on the right page. Amen. So I had to look back and go, what was that page? I was on the wrong page. And so... I'll be honest, the positive about your eyes kind of starting to go bad and stuff is when you take your glasses off, the crowd looks more full. I'm just kidding. Amen. Yeah, keep them on. All right. Even with them on, huh? All right. Well, praise the Lord. Hey, I'm going to have Brother, be seated. I'm going to say something real quick, and then I'm going to have Brother Mark come, and he's going to share his salvation testimony tonight as we close out our meeting. But I was going to mention this. Some of you may have noticed that the dice were here this morning, and they're making a transition, okay? And just through prayer and seeking the Lord, as Brother Dice was praying and his family, he felt that God, matter of fact, he was watching a class and was talking about the good and perfect and good, acceptable and perfect will of God. And he said, I was praying about that. He said, the more I prayed about that, the more I realized that God's perfect will for me is not to be a church planter. He does believe God, of course, wants him in ministry at some point, but that's not the specific direction God has for him. And it's important to be in the perfect will of God. Amen. Amen. And so we talked about that, and I encouraged him that it would be good for them to go ahead and come back here then. And we're going to have some of our Bible college students go to Grace for certain services and be a help there with various different things and in their place. I just want you to know that God's in that, okay? And I don't want you to think, well, something's wrong, or there's nothing wrong, there's no problem. But just through prayer and seeking the Lord, and they feel that led that way, and I felt led that way. As a matter of fact, I said, I feel like I want to talk to you about something, and I don't even know how you're going to take this. And as soon as I said it, they said, oh, we're so glad that you said that. We've been praying about that, and God laid it on our heart, but we didn't know how to tell you. So anyway, the Lord is good, and he always leads and guides, all right? And so you be in prayer, of course, as they make that transition. Pray for Grace. They've already sat and gone and visited all the folks. And actually, they're going to go this evening for the services, and after the service, that he's going to be preaching tonight, and then they're going to have a fellowship dinner afterwards as a farewell to them up there at Grace. And so everything's good in that vein, and so when you see them sneak out just in a little bit, that's what's going on, along with Brother Carter and Mrs. Carter, and Austin's going to go with them tonight, right? Is that right? So anyway, you be in prayer for them and pray for the transition and Grace and for our Bible college students. Great opportunity for training purposes at a church plant. Amen. So be in prayer for those things. All right. I didn't mention it this morning, but it's good to have Andrea with us. And she snuck in here for a few days to see her folks. And good to have her with us in the services. And praise the Lord for that. I'm going to ask Mark to come and share his testimony at this time.
Amen. So, I was brought up Catholic. And you hear of Catholicism, everyone has different ideas of what's true Catholicism. And it's interesting because you have, first thing a lot of us think of is hypocrisy with Catholicism. Of course, there's a lot of things that most everything Catholicism has wrong. One thing that I do appreciate, early on, from my childhood all the way through my adult life, I was taught the importance of going to church. So let me start with, before, when you hear someone saying they were raised this way or raised that way, our first thing that a lot of us like to do, myself included especially, because I was brought up this way, is to kind of pick it apart. But just remember that... if there's any one thing that a lot of them have right, is they go. A lot of them are really diligent on going to church every Sunday. So that being said, My mom and dad instilled that in me, and I was the one of the four kids that really loved it. I loved going to church. I loved hearing what they had to say there, but I knew from a very young age there was a lot of things wrong. So I was very faithful in attending. We all had no choice anyway, but I didn't just attend. I intended. Catholics, you don't have a choice anyway, and nor do most of us. It's not like I could stay home. Interestingly enough, my brothers and sisters would spend that time on Sundays finding ways to say they were sick and they wanted to stay home, but they had to go. But I had the right attitude. I was extremely confused because there's so many things that are said that just don't match up with the lifestyle that comes behind it. And one of the things that always confused me is why I never had one of these. My mom did. So there are actually some Catholics that have Bibles at home. It's usually a parent. They don't really instill it with their children. My mom was a prayer warrior, but she prayed with a rosary. And I never understood why she had to go to some guy that died that then takes it to Jesus. So she prayed to the saints. So when I was in college and graduated, I had my own choice now, right? So I was excited to have that freedom. I went to Western Michigan, and on Western Michigan's campus, they had a lot of people. They had a lot of good ministry out there that they would witness. There was a lot of good witness ministries. And I was one of the ones that, in my mind at the time, had the inopportunity of having people witness to me. And boy, did I hate that. So there were these two guys that would witness to me that would always come to the gym. And at the time, I felt like I had a really good life. I was in really good shape. Biggest thing to me was staying in shape, and I'd go to the local gym on campus, and whenever I'd see these guys, I was one of those ones that we deal with now when we're doing a witness, and I'd kind of see them, and they'd kind of catch my eye. I'd go the other way and pretend like I wasn't going towards the gym, but can't tell you how many workouts I missed because I knew that they were waiting for me there. That's what we should do, right? So, but I was fooling myself to say that I knew Jesus, that I was a Christian. I didn't understand this saved thing, though. So that put a lot of red flags in my mind because they would say the word saved a lot. And in the Catholic faith, you don't hear that. You're told that you're going to heaven and that God loves everyone. We're all the children of God, right? So long story short, I was excited after my second year. I got a chance to get out of the dorms and move into a place with my parents' choice of where I could live. So I decided to join Phi Sigma Kappa. And I thought, what a great deal. Here I can go to my fraternity house, get drunk on Friday and Saturday nights, and I can roll myself out of bed and Sunday morning go to the Catholic church right behind my fraternity house. That was actually one of my choices because I was brought up thinking, you know, go to church on Sundays and you're being a good Christian. That was the extent of it. And I really didn't understand how that was wrong. So what put me on my quest to start looking for a church, I'll never forget this. I don't even remember. It's been a long time. But I remember during a certain part of the service in the Catholic church. Anyone ever here raised Catholic? I bet you see a lot of hands go up. Oh, believe it or not, not too many. So, you know, there's that part where they do the Catholic Creed. And it's basically a script that you learn, you memorize from a young age. And here I'm at, in that point of the service where people are telling how excited they are to tell people that they know God, right? And I started quoting it just like everyone else. And it's just a memory thing, kind of like memorizing verses, right? You memorize a script in this case, is what I like to call it, telling about what you believe in. And as everyone's saying it, from youngest to oldest, almost 100% of the people had it memorized. And I looked around the room, and I looked around the room, and all I saw were a bunch of stiff bodies talking about how they love God. No emotion. And I heard the part, we acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. And these are babies that are being sprinkled on water, and they're told that now that you know, they're going to go to heaven. So I looked around, I saw emotionless people talking about how they love God in what they're supposedly saying, not listening to a thing they're saying. And I literally I watch different kinds of stuff that I watch now, and all I could think of is those zombie movies when everyone's just kind of like this, you know. We acknowledge one baptism, forgiveness of sins. There's nothing to it. And everything about what they're saying, I guarantee if you were to ask anyone after that, most anyone after that, what did you just say? What do you believe? And they wouldn't be able to tell you, but they just said it. It wasn't from the heart. So I started seeking churches. Got 5 minutes, so I'm down to like one. I went searching for several years. I went to several different churches, and it got more and more confusing. But I knew this much. I knew that there was not genuine faith, and there wasn't really any way that I could truly say that I knew I was going to heaven when everyone would ask me that question. I knew that I believed in everything about Jesus. I didn't have any scripture. I didn't have a Bible. I never was raised with one. So when I was, I moved a couple times after that. I was in Boulder, Colorado. I don't even remember how exactly this happened, but I ended up having some friends from one of the churches I visited, and I started hanging out with them. And this is where I started to realize, if I were to be honest with myself, that I was not saved, that I did not truly have that relationship with Jesus. I had a friend named Scott Maslick and a friend, David Fisher, who were sold out for Christ. And where I started, after going to all these churches and hearing in some of them the true message of Jesus Christ, the true gospel truth, all I could think of along the way was the hypocrisy, because that's all I experienced in my life around friends that I had that were outside of church. But these guys were flawed. They were sinners. But they still loved the Lord, and they still quoted scripture. And I was embarrassed to tell them I didn't know any of those verses. And they say, you know, where it says in John 3:16, where it says in Philippians 4. And I had no idea what they're talking about. So I played the game. I was good at over about 6 years of developing the lingo to think I was fooling everyone that I knew Jesus, but I knew in my heart of hearts I did not. They started asking me to come to their church, and I would sit in their pews with them. And I don't know, they were a singles group. There was probably 8 or 10 of them over the period of time that I'd sit with them. I don't know if they really, I knew a couple knew I wasn't saved, but others, I think I had them fooled pretty good. But I knew I didn't have anyone fooled. And it was just tearing me up inside. And I was embarrassed. I was one of those ones you hear about all the time, that I was embarrassed to go down that aisle. I had a good life. I had a really good life. I was in tip-top shape. I was a personal trainer at the time. I made pretty decent money. I started getting messed up with things. I ended up having a terrible relationship, and nothing brought peace. So I drowned myself in sorrows with alcohol. I drowned myself in sorrows with going to the gym and spending 2-3 hours in the gym, and I never still had that joy. Until I finally said, stop church hopping, looking for a particular church. And this church at the time, it was not a Baptist church. They had some things wrong, but I did hear the gospel truth. I did hear the true gospel. And I heard the message of Jesus Christ dying for our sins. And I finally stopped playing the games. I finally stopped pretending like I can fool everybody. And then hopefully I'll do enough things to outweigh the bad things. So I'm in the pew one day. Again, it was not a Baptist church. I knew, interestingly enough, all these churches I was checking out, I could see the flaws because I could see hypocrisy and I could see a lot of things wrong. The music wasn't doing it for me anymore. I was always following the music. I used to call the Baptist church music Little House on the Prairie music. Now I wouldn't have it any other way. So the message that was preached that night, all I know is that pastor was preaching to me, and I'd say halfway through the message, I was already wanting to go down there, but I already knew that there was that time to go. And I should have been that one that ran down. But I was at that point where I already knew that there was a Jesus that loved me so much. And I actually finally listened to the verses that died for my sins, and that I knew for a fact that I've been living a lie all these years. I've been faithful going to church, but I was also faithful living a double life and living a complete hypocrisy, getting drunk at night, thinking that I can just go to Sundays and make up for it. And then it wasn't works-based anymore. So to towards the very end of the message, they did the altar call, and I literally about ran down to the altar. I got on my knees. I was saved right on the spot, right there at the altar. I did not wait a minute because the Lord had already been picking at my heart and picking at my heart and picking at my heart for probably 6 years. I probably visited 40, 50 churches. I never found the perfect church. That one wasn't. There still isn't one. But I knew that there was a message for me. I knew, first of all, that the Lord loved me. And I finally understood that he loved me enough that he didn't want me to go to hell. He wanted me to be saved. So he made it clear in his message that if I were to die today, I would burn in hell. But he made it clear that he wanted me to come with him to heaven, and then he'll take care of it. And I finally said, you know what, forget it. I don't understand it. I don't want to change my life. But I gave my life to Jesus. I asked him into my heart that very day right there on an altar just like this. And then the journey went from there. I didn't, after I was saved, this was April. I never wrote that date down. That was the part that I doubted my salvation. Careful with that, by the way, guys. I was one of those ones, I never wrote it down because they didn't say to write that down. I didn't think anything of it because I really didn't care. I'm saved now. I'm going to heaven. I'm heaven bound. I'm saved by the blood of Christ. Never wrote it down, but I know it was around April of 94. I'll tell you what, I tell people all the time, I don't care. I told my kids this morning, I said, I think it was this morning. I was explaining to them how important it is, what your most important day in your life is. It's not marrying my beautiful wife, Michelle. My favorite day, the most important day of my life, is the day that I got saved in April of 1994 by the blood of Christ. My second good day was my wife. My third is the birth of my three kids. But never, ever think of any other day as the best day of your life than the day you got saved. And so it's April 94. I've been saved for 29 years now. And it's been a great experience ever since. I'll give another testimony on the rest, how it went from there. But I will say this much. After I got saved, I tried living that life. And this is the cool part. All you got to do is think about, once you get saved, is anyone here that's been recently saved and they're already doubting their salvation? I was one of the things that I did for a hobby was playing pool. I played on three pool teams. I was captain of two of them. My life was the bar. Sundays I was Mr. Religious Guy before I was saved, and then I go hang out at the bars and get drunk all night. I tried going back because I didn't get discipled once I got saved. I tried going back. I tried going to those gyms, and I didn't have a clue. Why is it I can't enjoy my life? Why can't I enjoy picking up a pool stick anymore? I just won't drink anymore. I couldn't even get myself to go into the bars I went to for about 3-4 months, and I finally went back, and just picking up a stick made me sick, and I literally had to walk out, and I still didn't get it, but the Holy Spirit did. And that's how you know, is even if you're not discipled right off the bat, the Holy Spirit's going to guide you, and we just need to trust that. And that it's just awesome. To this day, people ask, how come I don't even tell people, how come you don't play pool anymore? I just can't. My dad tried to get me when he was a snowbird. So he would ask me to come play pool. And you go into these retirement communities, they always have these pool halls, right? And there's no drinking or anything. But I couldn't even play pool with my own father. Loved him with all my heart. I couldn't play pool with my dad anymore. And I tried explaining that to him, but he never understood why it is. I'm a new creature in Christ. So God wouldn't even let me enjoy the things I used to because it could pull me back. Anyway, I know that's way more than 5 minutes. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for salvation in Christ, Lord God. Thank you so much for me being saved by your grace, not by my works. Thank you, Lord God, for every soul that you have saved here. Every single person here within these four walls that is saved by the blood of Christ, and only by your grace are we saved. By faith in Christ. Help those that are still struggling to understand that, Lord God, that they don't have to do anything by any means to try to earn that spot, because they never will. None of us are worthy. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. I pray if there be anyone tonight that is within these four walls that is struggling with that, I hope this testimony is encouragement to them, Lord God, that we can't earn our way to heaven. We can go to church every Sunday. We could volunteer to do things outside the church, the worldly things, like the Red Cross and anything else that would be service to mankind, or we could even surrender to every type of ministry here within the church, give all of our money. But if we don't have that personal relationship with Jesus, it's meaningless. Help those that are struggling with that, Lord God, that may not know Christ, to hear the message tonight, to hear the salvation message. I thank you for my testimony, Lord God. Thank you for saving my soul. And Lord, we thank you so much for this church. We thank you so much for Brother Smith and how you're using him, Lord God. We pray that just the Holy Spirit to work through him today to make a clear message to those here, every one of us, for us all to grow in Christ, those that are saved, and those to be drawn to Christ that are not. And we give you all the glory and the honor in Jesus' name. Amen.
You'll stand with me again. We're going to sing one more hymn, hymn 281. Hymn 281, Pass Me Not, O Gentle Savior. Maybe you've never answered that first calling on your life that God has for you, or maybe it's another call God has for you. Hymn number 281. Pass me not, O gentle Savior, hear my heart.
Pass me by. Chapter number 4, the book of Ephesians, chapter number 4. And let me just say thank you so much for your kindness and what a joy it's been to be here again. And I'm always pray for your church and pray for your pastor that God would continue to strengthen and protect and to enable you to continue to do the work of God that he has given here. We appreciate your prayers for my family and I. It's kind of a small family now, just my daughter Lydia. And the rest of them are all off doing as God would have for them. And as we continue the work of God there, and we appreciate your support helping us do the work of God. The book of Ephesians tonight, if you would stand, and we're going to read, I said chapter 4, but chapter number 3 is where I'd like to be. Ephesians chapter number 3 tonight. And we've been looking at different things in the scriptures that are by faith. And we understood about justification, propitiation, and of course, salvation. And there is no way to have that without faith. Tonight's message is a little bit more geared to those of us that would believe on Jesus Christ. And the Apostle Paul, in this chapter, chapter 3 of the book of Ephesians, he has many wonderful things he writes to the church. And I believe it's important to understand that he talks about, in verse number 9, to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the world hath been hid in God, who created all things by Jesus Christ, to the intent that now unto the principalities and powers in heavenly places might be known by the church, the manifold wisdom of God. And we are going to see tonight how important the church is in our life, and that is God's plan for us tonight. But in the midst of that, Paul is giving some instruction. In verse 13, he says, "Wherefore I desire that ye faint not at my tribulations for you, which is your glory." And Paul definitely had a desire that the church at Ephesus would do great things for God, and he didn't want them to faint. And I wish that more of God's people today would have that same desire, amen? Amen. That they would, that anything they do would not cause the church to faint.
Right.
And boy, if we could understand that everything we and how we respond to things in life affects those that are around us. And boy, the church is so important in this day and age. But then he makes this transition to verse 14, and he says, "For this cause I bow my knees unto the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ." So he's making a prayer. He says, "Of whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that he would grant you according to the riches of his glory to be strengthened with might by his Spirit in the inner man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith." And there's that little statement in the middle of Paul's prayer, that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, "that ye being rooted and grounded in love may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth and length and depth and height, and to know the love of Christ which passeth knowledge, that ye might be filled with all the fullness of God. Now unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us, unto him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages, world without end. Amen." Let's pray tonight. Father in heaven, Lord, I pray you would take the next few minutes of time, and Father, you would teach us, Lord, a great truth from your scriptures, God, that would impact our church, Lord, for your glory. And God, I pray tonight for Bethaven Baptist Church that you would make it a church, God, that would do even greater things than have already been accomplished. And Lord, that you would have your power and your presence very evident every day. Lord, help me to speak the words that you want spoken tonight. Lord, would you teach us what you want us to learn? And Father, we ask this in the precious name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you. You can be seated tonight. I was thinking the other night as we broke into groups and we prayed, what a wonderful service that was. I was in a church this year where, before I ever arrived, the pastor felt really burdened just to cancel the preaching services, and he said, "We're just going to pray." He said, "Do you still want to come?" I said, "Well," I said, "it's already scheduled and planned. If you don't mind, I'll pray with you." Amen. And we had a wonderful week and just prayed every night. In fact, we had more people attend the services than we'd ever had at any revival meeting I'd ever preached there. We had longer services. We, you know, typically the expectation is if you start at 7, you finish at 8. Now, don't worry, we're not following that tonight. Well, we might finish at 8, amen, that'll be good. But, you know, that's just one of the things that in churches in America, we're so caught up with the clock, you know, and we start and we finish and that's our life. And when we had those prayer services, typically, you know, we would start at 7, we'd finish at 8:15, and depending on the length of the testimonies, amen. But the prayer services went on for an hour and a half. 2 hours, and people prayed, and God answered some great prayers that week for that church in some wonderful ways, and the power of prayer is so very important.
Yeah,
but if you remember, the disciples came to Jesus Christ, and they said, "Lord, teach us to pray," and while I understand that we can collect prayer requests, and I'm not saying tonight that we should not have prayer requests, but the reality is that most of our prayer requests in our churches is simply about health and wealth. I need a job, I need finances, or I'm sick. And amen, we ought to pray about those things. The prayer of faith shall save the sick, amen. And I believe God heals, and we ought to pray about those things. But when I read this passage tonight, and you could read over in Colossians, perhaps another illustration, over in Thessalonians a little bit, Paul prayed for the churches, and Paul shared different things that he would pray for these churches. And I believe if the Apostle Paul prayed for something in a church, that it would be good for you and I to learn to pray for the same things. And so tonight's message is just a very simple message. If you're an outliner, you can already see it, and you could probably just write it down and go home if you want, I guess. But I want us to see tonight the four things that Paul listed here that he prayed for the church at Ephesus, and challenge you and I tonight to consider this as we pray one for another, as we pray for the pastors, we pray for the leadership, as we pray for the ministries, as we pray for those that labor, as we pray for those that sit in the pews next to us. What are some things that we should pray about? And of course, in verse 17, we saw one of those, that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith. But before we get to that one, let's look at the first couple of things here tonight. And so the first thing is found in verse number 16, when Paul says that that Christ would grant you according to the riches of his glory. And that's an important thing, because verse 21 ends with the glory of Christ. I'm so grateful that when we pray, we're not praying according to the current political, financial climate of the world. I'm so glad that our prayers are not hindered by policies of people. And Paul makes that very clear, that he would grant these things according to the riches of his glory. And then the first thing that Paul prays for is that the church would be strengthened with might by his Spirit in the inner man. Now, that's a tremendous prayer thing, if you would just pause and think about that for a moment. I wonder how much we pray for our pastors to be strengthened by the Spirit of God in the inner man.
Right.
Because that's where the battle lies.
Yeah.
The battle doesn't lie out here in this world. The battle lies in the inner man.
Sure.
I wonder how many people have fallen. We're really good about praying for people after they fall. Which is not wrong. Please don't misunderstand me. I'm not criticizing any of those things. But wouldn't it have been better if we prayed before they fell?
Right. Yeah.
Hello. I mean, we pray after somebody loses in the battle. After a brother or sister in Christ that used to sit in the bench with us has wandered away and been destroyed by sin and ate up by the devil, we begin to pray for their restoration and for everything that takes place in that life. But honestly and seriously, did we pray for them before? In the last 2 years, I've had several friends of mine that have fallen into different sins that have disqualified them from ministry. And God began to grip my heart, because I was guilty after they fell of saying, Lord, restore them. But then looking back over my prayer life and saying, how much did I really pray for them to be strengthened in the inner man? How many times did I get down on my knees and say, God? Now, you know, I prayed for them to get a church building. Hello? I prayed for them to get a visa to get to the mission field. Good things. Don't misunderstand me. Good things. But what good is a building and a visa if they fall? And God began to burden my heart as I began to see this in the Scriptures, that I have something to pray about concerning every one of my preacher friends.
Right.
Concerning every member in my church back in Ohio. Concerning every believer that I meet that I would want to pray for. You know, we often go up and we say, you know, hey, brothers, is there something I can pray for you about? Well, you already have something right here in the Bible. Amen. Could you imagine what would happen if people began to pray for one another? Because we do believe God answers prayer, amen, right? Do we believe we have a God that hears in heaven and does great and mighty things? Could you imagine if people would take serious some of these things in the Scriptures and get a list of all of the staff of the church and every single day begin to pray for those people and say, I pray for Pastor Carter, for Mrs. Carter, I pray for the other Pastor Carter and the other Mrs. Carter and the other Pastor Carter and the other Mrs. Carter, amen? And you just pray for these people. And Lord, I pray that you would strengthen them by your Spirit in the inner man.
Right.
You see, you don't have to know any other details.
Right.
Are you hearing me?
Right.
But if we would just pray for them. And if you would take the people that are in this church, and you got a name of every member of the church and every visitor of the church and every friend of the church, and you just got down on your face before God and you said, Lord, I pray for this person, God, that you would strengthen them by your spirit in the inner man. Maybe we would have less people falling. You say, well, man, if I start doing that, I don't know if I'm going to be able to get through all. Okay, well, then pray for groups of them every other day or something. Amen. But I'm just saying, grasp this truth that Paul said. Paul said, I'm praying for the believers at Ephesus. I'm praying for you that you would be strengthened by his spirit, by his might in the inner man. Yeah. And so often our prayers are just about exterior instead of internal things. Do you follow what I'm saying tonight? I'm not going to dwell there. I want to give this to you tonight, let you think about it, and ask God to help you to do it. Notice the second thing that he says in verse 17, which is what drew me to this tonight, that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith. Is that talking about salvation?
No.
Thank you, Pastor. Amen. He said it quick, so none of you would say yes. Amen. It's absolutely not. There's no way, because he's praying about who?
The saints,
the church, right? And so if you are saved, you're in the church, he's not praying, Lord, I help the believers in Ephesus to get saved. That doesn't make sense. But he does pray that Christ would dwell in your heart. The key word there is the word dwell. Because salvation is much more than just saying, Lord, come into my heart, all right? I think we'd understand that. But as a believer, Christ does, he's in you, Christ in you, the Holy Spirit of God. But there's a difference about that little word dwell. Now, I'm a traveler, all right? And I usually have my trailer, and I have my house, and, you know, I do what I do in my house, amen? But occasionally when I'm not in my house and I'm staying in somebody else's house like I am this week, and people often say this, and they say this to your pastor when he travels, and you've been guests, people that you walk in the house and they say, Brother Smith, just make yourself at home. Now, that is the biggest lie in the world. Because they know I'm leaving someday. Could you imagine if all of a sudden I went to the post office and changed my mailing address to their house? They said, what are you doing? You said, make myself at home, amen. Well, that's not what we meant. You know, I get on the phone, I call my kids, hey, come on out here to Oklahoma. I got us a place to live. So we just use that as a statement, don't we? I mean, could you imagine if I walked in and I said, really, make myself at home. All right, I'm going to dwell here now. Okay, I'm going to dwell here now. That is the ugliest picture I've ever seen. It's gone.
Yeah.
I'm putting my own pictures on the wall.
Yeah.
Amen. That's why Pastor Carter let me stay in his house no more. Amen.
Yeah.
He downsized just so I couldn't make myself at home. But I love trailers. Amen. Did you follow what I'm saying? I mean, if you make something your home, that means you dwell there. I mean, could you imagine? Oh, really? Make myself at home? Well, let me go see what's in this closet. No, Brother Smith, don't open that closet. Well, you told me to make myself at home, and in my house, I open every closet. Are you following me? So Paul said, I'm praying that Christ may dwell in your house. In other words, make it his place. Not your place. I remember when I was getting married, and I was close to getting married, and I moved in with some guys to save some money, and about the most terrifying experience of my life is to live with three other college guys, amen? Because I'm kind of one of those guys that likes things kind of neat a little bit, you know. These guys, they emptied the trash when they washed dishes when the cupboard was empty, you know, stuff like that. But I was getting married, saving money. It was worth it. Until one night I came in from work real late, and I went to lay down on had a couch that was my bed. I didn't have a room, just slept on the couch. And I laid on that couch, and there was something on there. I jumped up off the couch, you know, and it was gross. And I flipped the light on because, you know, what in the world, I'm on my couch? And one of my roommates had ran over an animal and he'd stretched that thing out, you know, sell the hide. I laid on that thing, you know. That was it. I said, I'm getting my own place. I did. Went out the next day. I told my wife to be Reese. I said, Reese, I said, I know it's going to cost a little money, but I'm moving out of those guys. I can't handle it. I'm getting my own apartment a month early. Paid the rent. But it was kind of nice because then when I'd go to work, she'd go to the apartment and she would do things. And it was just a joy. It was fun. It was fun to come home from work. And first thing I'd do is flip on lights and see what she'd change. You know, pictures here, this, there, that, there. You know, she was making that place. You know, when I moved in, it was just bare walls and, you know, some dirty socks and stuff, you know. I actually come in and find my clothes folded, my shirts ironed for the day. That was a blessing, amen. Even coordinated colors so they would match, amen. My favorite thing was the night I came home, and I got home from work at 7 in the morning, came in there, got in there, flipped lights on. I'm looking around trying to figure out, what did she do this day, you know, because I knew she'd been in there working. Couldn't see anything. Walked in the bathroom, and there was the toilet. And it had lace all around the toilet. Amen? Now, let me tell you what she was doing. She was preparing to dwell there. She was making that her home. Do you hear what Paul is praying for? Aren't we good at complaining about people? Well, I wish that person would figure this out. I wish they'd figure that out. I wish they'd do this. How about just get on your knees and say, Lord, I pray for that brother, I pray for that sister, that you could dwell in their heart.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
Simple, isn't it? Instead of being all fussy and arguing and disagreeing, and why not pray and see what God can do? Amen?
Yeah.
Because after all, if God dwells in their heart, that's going to reflect on the outside.
Yeah.
And they'll be what God wants them to be.
Right.
That's like an endless prayer list, isn't it? Because once again, you could just start talking about your missionaries, you talk about people in the church, you talk about your own family, and just make your list of all these people and say, Lord, I pray, God, I pray that you would dwell in their heart. And here's the two key words, by faith, that they would trust you. That's where we struggle, isn't it? I don't think tonight, most of you here tonight probably don't struggle with when the preaching's preaching about what you should do. You kind of know that. But doing it by faith, trusting God. What a great prayer request, amen? That we would just start praying for people and saying, Lord, I pray for those families. I pray for myself. I pray for others that Christ, you would dwell in their heart by faith, that they would let you do the work that you want to do. Look at the next thing Paul says. Continuing on, verse number 7, that semicolon right there, that ye being rooted and grounded in love. Now that's an interesting one because that's what's taking place in their life. As Christ is there, they're being rooted and grounded in love. And he extends upon that and says, may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth and length and depth and height, and to know the love of Christ which passeth knowledge. Wow, isn't that amazing? That's a great prayer request, isn't it? That people would get rooted and grounded in love, and they are because they're saved and Christ is in them and they're growing in that area, but they would begin to comprehend that. Do you think any of us tonight truly comprehend the depths of the love of God? That's what we were trying to preach about on Thursday night and Saturday night. Trying to get us to understand the love of God. How great it is, how deep it is. And what a prayer request. Dear God, as my fellow believers, as my pastor, as my friends are growing the love of God, that God, they would truly begin to comprehend the vastness of it, how great God's love is for us. Why? Because the love of Christ constrains us. These are Bible things to pray for. These are things that I don't need to go to anybody and say, what should I pray about for you? I can pray about it. Before they fall, before they get bitter, before they get discouraged, before they quit serving God. You see, sometimes we don't pray because we don't know what to pray about. But if you just got the people that God has for you to pray for and just started praying for them specifically, just these three areas, your prayer time is going to get big. But it's not going to be empty, vain prayers. See, we need to pray more. But often we don't know what to pray about. Because sometimes we do feel a little bit empty praying for the same physical things over and over again. Not even really having any faith that they're going to take place. But these are things that God can and will do. And then in verse number 19, the last thing that Paul mentions there, that ye might be filled with all the fullness of God. That is an amazing prayer request. To be filled with all the fullness of God. I brought an illustration again tonight. I brought a glass. I put a rock in it. And this is so simple. I'll put some water in there. And you know tonight, if I ask you this question, is that glass full of water? It's not, is it? Why is it not full of water? Because there's a rock in there, right? So how can I fill this glass with water, pour more water in, right? I'd do it, but I don't want to make a mess on the pulpit, amen? It'd be really silly for me to be sitting up here tonight saying, I'm trying to get this glass full of water, and I just keep pouring water in. You say, well, it's full to the top, but we all know it's not full of water, is it? Now, that verse in the Bible says Paul was praying for the church that they would be filled, not filled with God, but a very specific phrase, filled with all the fullness of God. Just like I suppose we could put the rock in there and say it's full of water, but it's not full of the fullness of water. And the only way for that glass to be filled with the fullness of water is if we take the rock out. And the very moment I drop that rock back in, water's going to spill out, and that glass is no longer filled with the fullness of water, is it? Paul said, I'm praying for the believers to be filled with all the fullness of God. He wasn't trying to tell them what rocks to take out. He was just saying they need to be filled with the fullness of God. Once again, that's like an endless prayer list, isn't it? Lord, I pray for my pastor that he be filled with all the fullness of God. I pray for the leaders, the helpers, the servants in the church, that they be filled with all the fullness of God. I pray that our teen department be filled with all the fullness of God. I pray that our children that are born again and saved be filled with all the fullness of God. Do you understand what I'm saying tonight? Those aren't empty, void prayers. Because do you understand what starts taking place when those prayers start getting answered? Revival. Revival. Now, please don't misunderstand me. I get excited when somebody was sick and they get better, amen? But that's not going to produce revival. I get excited when, you know, God answers prayers and people get a job. I'm excited for that, amen? I believe God answers those prayers. But that doesn't produce revival. That doesn't produce the change in hearts and lives. Because here's the danger of that. Well, man, if you go to that church, you can get healed. That's why they came to Jesus by the multitudes, but it didn't change their lives. In fact, he healed 10 lepers and only one came back and said, thank you. Jesus fed the multitudes. Their bellies were full. But that didn't change their lives. We need lives changed. Now, please don't go out here tonight and say, Brother Smith says we shouldn't pray for health and we shouldn't pray for jobs. We should pray for those things. But these are the things that change lives. And sadly, we often pray for them too late. We pray for them afterwards. Instead of being proactive and saying, God, here's the people you've put in my life. And these are some things I want you to do for them. I'm just trying to be transparent tonight. I haven't always prayed that way. But God began to show that to me, and it changed the way I pray. When I'm driving down the road, I have four things. And I start thinking about my pastor friends and churches and people I know. Because, see, I don't know if they're healthy. I don't know if they need money. I don't know if they, but I know they need all these things. And I've been asking people, pray for me that way. Because I need all those things. I need God to work in my life. And so, it's a simple challenge tonight. Because look at what it says. We already read the verses, but look at what Paul says here. Because after he said that you might be filled with all the fullness of God, verse 20 says, now unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think. Isn't that amazing? That's revival. That's when God gets into everything. That's when God begins to do something. Because it says right there, the last of that verse, according to the power that worketh in us. And these things are about the power of God working in us. And God is able to. And God is able to cause a preacher or an individual or somebody in the church to be filled with all the fullness of God. He is able for somebody to be, you know, letting Christ dwell in them. He is enabling them to be strengthened by His might, by His Spirit, that they would stand. He enables them to know the love of Christ and to comprehend it and to understand it greater and greater, and therefore for God to do greater and mightier things. And where does this all take place? The last verse. Unto him be glory in the church. It is the church's responsibility to pray one for another. But we are so guilty, of only praying after the fact. When the trouble comes, we hit the altar. When we hear the problem, we start praying for the brother. We hear the family issue and we need to pray for that family, which we do. Amen. But wouldn't it have been a whole lot better to have never seen the problem? To never see the failure? Because we were praying for them and they had victory. And they were full. They were changed. And God would get the glory. And see, this wasn't just for Paul and the Ephesian church. Because what does it say? In the church, by Christ Jesus, throughout all ages, world without end. Are we still living in the world? It hasn't ended yet, has it? And the same God that did the great and mighty works in the Bible. And hear me tonight. They had nothing even in comparison to all the physical things we have today. They didn't have buildings like this. They didn't have PA systems like this. They didn't have screens to put the verses all up on. They didn't have media and printing presses to print everything. Do you understand that, right? They had nothing compared to what we have today in the physical realm. But they turned the world upside down. Yep. We're not doing it today. You have a pretty exceptional church here with all the men that are being sent out of this church to do the work of God, and I praise the Lord very mightily for that. But we're still not getting the job done. And by the way, if you're a church that's trying to get the job done, you need those prayers. You need those prayers. lest Satan find an advantage in us. So my message tonight is very simple. That we need to be busy praying about the things that Paul said, that God said, are important to pray about. And not just after the problem occurs, but before it occurs. And there is no excuse for us tonight to ever say, I don't know what to pray about. Because there's just four. We could go to Colossians, we go to Thessalonians, and I could add five or six more things to the list that Paul prayed for in the church. And if we would make those things out and start putting everybody down, probably we wouldn't have as much time to do some of the other things we're doing that have no value. But we would see God doing great and mighty things. Let's pray tonight. Father in heaven, Lord, I pray you'd help us this evening. Father, with just some simple truths, Lord. And God, I know that in this building tonight are people that love you and strive to live for you, that give and sacrifice and labor and desire. Father, no way tonight do I intend to stand up here and try to preach this as a rebuke. But God, is an exhortation, because Satan is real. The battle is real. And God, we need to pray one for another. Lord, this church needs to pray for their pastor. Pray for their leadership. Pray for their wives, their children. They need to pray for the deacons. They need to pray for the Sunday school teachers, the bus workers. They need to pray for the choir. They need to pray for the people that sit next to them, for the men that lock up the building. God, they need to pray for every single person. And yes, Lord, we need to pray for the physical things that are burdensome. But, oh God, how we need to pray for the spiritual things that'll give us the grace to walk through the trials of life. And Father, I pray tonight we'd be encouraged, be reminded. And God, we would take this matter of prayer very serious as we pray one for another. Father, we ask this tonight in your precious name. We'll just stand to our feet with our heads bowed, our eyes closed. And just as the song is saying tonight, you do as God tells you to do, amen. Maybe you just want to come down and pray for a little bit. Kneel at your seat, sit at your seat, get on your knees. Maybe just pray for some people around you tonight for these things. Maybe pray for your own self in these areas. But let's just spend some time in prayer as we close out this service. Pray for the Dices. We're going to pray in a little bit specifically for them. Many needs they have. Pray for your missionaries. But let's be a people of prayer.
Sweet hour of prayer.
Still folks praying. I needed that message tonight. That was help for me. And I'm guilty of that as well. Forgive me for that. Correct that in me. You don't miss the opportunity to respond to it. let's have our ushers come at this time and take up our offering. Brother Smith's starting to make me as nervous as Brother Gates, putting all these fluids and stuff all over the pulpit. At least he didn't pull out a command strip and stick it on there, you know. That's still a notch above that, you know. So, but I know he does all this magic stuff. I know he probably has some acids and things like that. Don't bring those up in my pulpit, all right? Don't do that. Amen. Amen. Let's pray. We'll take up our offering. Brother Charles, would you close this prayer?